And a very warm welcome to our service for Advent 2. God, our Father, our Mother and our Shepherd, you come close to us when we need you, and you are there when we think that we don't.
Good and faithful God,
you are beside us all the way, when we notice and when we don't. Tending and mindful, leading and feeding, your eyes never stray from us. Call us back again, merciful God, to be with you in this hallowed time and space. Call us beyond our small notions, beyond our great dreams, to see beauty and potential where we haven't thought to look. May these days and weeks be a true advent of new thinking, new experiencing, new communion with you, our loving God. Amen. You are wise, O Lord our God, in giving us waiting times. Thank you for what we have learned in those times, to trust while we have not yet received, to dig in and build resilience while we live without, to hang on tenaciously in the seeming nothingness. Thank you for the chance to stop and question, how ready am I? To take stock, prepare and reorder our priorities, to keep asking in accordance with your confidence, with our confidence in you, to do the things to help the birth of all that we hope for. God, you too are waiting. Thank you for waiting for us, waiting for our attention whilst we are preoccupied, waiting for our cooperation because you believe in the work that we can do, waiting with your story to retell and retell, because we always need to hear it again and again. Thank you that you waited for the right time and became one of us. Thank you, Jesus, for your waiting and preparing so that through you we would see the life of God walking amongst us. Give us wisdom in this waiting time, so that when we come again, we are ready to welcome with open arms all that you have yet to offer and teach and give. In your name we ask it, our friend and saviour. Amen. Amen. And we turn to confession. Dearest God, constant in the face of our fickleness, covenant keeper in the face of our betrayals, reveal to us again just how kind and forgiving you are. Where we are being too hard on ourselves, help us to learn tenderness. When we start raking over old hurts, teach us to soothe what is sore and to trust that you are putting us back together again. You sit with us in all that we find hard to move past, our own failings and the failings of others which hurt us. We look to you for courage and grace to forgive ourselves and forgive others. We look to you for the example of bearing grievance without hitting back. Make us merciful as you are merciful, and generous in our warmth towards all. Amen. Amen. May Almighty God, whose love is infinite and mercy everlasting, forgive you your sins and welcome you back into his peace.
Our reading is from the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 11. A shoot shall come out of the stock of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be full of knowledge of the Lord, as the waters covers the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples, The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold, pure gold, refined as fire. My heart's one desire is to be
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the tree. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In today's Gospel, John the Baptist tells his hearers to bear fruit worthy of repentance. If our hearts have turned afresh to God, then our lives should show this by how we care for each other, how we care for ourselves, and how we care for the world around us. One saint who inspires me to do this is the saint we celebrate on Tuesday, the 6th of December, and whose name is inextricably linked to our Christmas celebrations, St. Nicholas, who became known as Santa Claus. He was born in Asia Minor on what is now the southern coast of Turkey. His parents were wealthy and devout Christians, bringing Nicholas up, surrounding him with love and with gospel stories of Jesus. Sadly, he lost both of them when he was still very young as a result of an epidemic. So at an early age, he became a wealthy young man, and he decided to follow Jesus' teaching and gave away his wealth to help the needy, the sick, and the suffering. And he entered the church, quite quickly becoming the Bishop of Myra whilst he was still relatively young. In those days, being a Christian wasn't easy, and the Roman Emperor Diocletian imprisoned many Christian leaders, including Nicholas. He died on the 6th of December in 6 AD. One of the legends that is well known but illustrates his humility and his generosity was his kindness to a poor man with three daughters. In those days, a father had to present a dowry for his daughters to ensure a good marriage. And without a dowry, a young woman was unlikely to marry, and her life could be a terrible struggle. It is said that as each daughter reached marriageable age, a bag of gold mysteriously appeared in their home, so the dowry could be paid. As the coming of age of the third daughter, the father kept watch, and as the bag of gold was tossed through the window, he saw that it was Nicholas who was responsible. According to legend, the bag landed in a stocking that was drying by the hearth, which was the origin of our tradition of putting stockings out at Christmas. Nicholas, as you know, is also the patron saint of children and of sailors. After his prayers to calm a storm saved seafarers, taking him back from his pilgrimage to the Holy Land when he was a young man. The stories of St. Nicholas have become a much loved part of our preparations for Christmas, but they remind us of the importance of practical generosity. Such generosity being our response to the generous love of God we celebrate at Christmas with the coming of Jesus, God's Son, who is, as some people have put it, God's love letter to the world. There are lots of ways to be generous, but I'd just like to think of a few this morning. Recently, Linda was given a get well card from one of the young people in the parish. She had made it, and it had on the envelope a quote that the young lady really liked. It was from Brad Montague, and it said, "Be somebody who makes everybody feel like a somebody." Be somebody who makes everybody feel like a somebody. Taking time to set aside all the thoughts inside our heads and our self-preoccupation and really pay attention to somebody, to really listen to them, can make such a difference to people. So often we listen to people with only some of our attention, with one ear, if you like, as we are thinking about what we are going to say, the story we are going to tell, the witty remark we are going to make when they finally shut up. Setting aside all this, being there for someone else really will make them feel like a somebody. And this can be especially important if you know someone is going through a hard time. But it is good in and of itself at any time to help someone feel like a somebody. Too often I have come away from conversations realizing that I have been speaking and full of myself rather than being truly generous and giving my time, attention and energy to the other person. Another way of expressing generosity is by being in touch with someone we haven't seen for a while. Perhaps, like happened to Linda, by making a card for them, something personal and meaningful that really does say, "I am thinking about you." Or maybe instead of just sitting down on an evening and watching TV, make the time to call someone on the phone and be present to them as you chat. Being generous with our time is the most precious thing, as it is the one resource that we have that is absolutely non-renewable. The book 4,000 Weeks, subtitled Time and How to Use It, is a graphic reminder of this. 4,000 weeks being an average lifespan. But then there is the practical generosity of how we use our money, and this is not to be underestimated. I listened to the Radio 4 appeal recently for a charity that supplies clean drinking water, and I was really struck by how having a pump in a village has all sorts of knock-on effects by way of health, education, and self-sufficiency. Material generosity supports such work. So as we are challenged by John the Baptist to bear fruit worthy of repentance, let us remember St. Nicholas and ask how God is challenging us to be generous this Advent. Amen. And so we share in our Advent Creed together. We believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth, the one who is full of patience, who is not afraid of silence, who does not need to fill each moment with activity and noise, the one who is beyond bluster and flurry, and who does not jostle for attention. We believe in God the Son, Saviour of creation, who slipped into Bethlehem one night, mostly unnoticed, who lived 30 years without headlines or hurry, who frequently took time alone with his patient father, who waited for the right time to become the suffering servant, who stood quietly before the noise of his accusers, whose silence overpowered their words, who died, then rose again on a quiet Sunday morning. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens, empowers, renews and refreshes, sometimes arriving with obvious power, sometimes with the quiet breath of a whisper. We believe in one God, who patiently waits for us, and who longs for us to do the same.
Oh, I will wait for you, I will wait for you.
Let us pray. Holy God of Advent, you became weak so that we could find strength in moments of heartbreak. You left the safety of your heaven to wander the wilderness of the world. Holding our hands when we feel hopeless, you set aside your glory to hold our pain, so we might be healed, even when there seems to be no hope. You became one of us, so we would never be alone in any moment, in any circumstances. Lord, in this season when every heart should be happy and light, many of us are struggling with the heaviness of life, with burdens that steal our joy. Fill us with your light instead of darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God of Advent, you sent John the Baptist to prepare the way. Help us to clear the way in our hearts and our minds, to concentrate on the true meaning of Christ's coming and not on the worldly things around us, which so often block out our thoughts and worship of you. Lord God, we live in disturbing days across the world, a world filled with doubt and conflict, inequality and injustice. Make this time of waiting the time of a new awakening of thought, consideration, endeavour and action by all leaders and all nations to bring about peace, freedom and understanding through the knowledge of the one true gift of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, Hear our prayer. Holy God of Advent, whose Son Jesus Christ understood people's fear and pain before they themselves were aware of them, have mercy on those in need, for the hungry and the homeless, for those in refugee camps and prisons, hospitals and care homes, and for those who are cared for in their own homes. We especially think of those suffering from COVID. Bless those who work to bring the relief of the sick. Inspire generosity and compassion in our hearts as we move into this time of goodwill to all people. Lord Jesus, pour out your Spirit on us today. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen.
Amen.
And we say together the prayer which Jesus taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armour of light, now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son Jesus Christ came to us in great humility, so that at the last, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal through him who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
We wait for your loving kindness, O Lord, in the midst of your temple. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. and we bow our heads for God's blessing. May God the Father, who loved the world so much that he sent his only Son, give you grace to prepare for eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. May God the Son, who comes to us as Redeemer and Judge, reveal to you the path from darkness to light.
Amen.
Amen. May God, the Holy Spirit, by whose working the Virgin Mary conceived the Christ, help you bear the fruits of holiness. Amen.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, your homes, and all whom you love, now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child to thy glorious throne.